great area for habituation, and the animals here and all the surrounding lodges are exposed to very similar behavior from their guides, and that means the spillover from animals moving territories means that a lot of the animals that move from other camps in the Sabi Sands to us are relaxed. However, to the north of us is the Manyaleti, and to the east the Kruger, and in those parks there's not the same level of habituation, so occasionally we get animals coming from those areas, especially the leopard, that are exceptionally skittish, and you only get fleeting glimpses of them. So we kind of half surrounded by well-habituated animals, and then the other half that can come in are from areas where they don't get the same level of vehicle exposure and contact, and therefore are not quite as relaxed. So we chatted about Djuma and the waterhole camera there a little bit earlier, and Ginny would like to know exactly where it is from here. It's probably about 15 kilometers in that direction to my right, to the south. You would have to cross the Sand River in order to get there. A beautiful big river that flows through the Sabi Sands, one of the two main rivers, the Sand River being one and the Sabi River being the other. And it's a river that I was lucky enough to drive along. I had a camp where I used to work south of us, and I actually used to drive around Djuma's property for a few months when I worked in the western section of the Sabi Sands. It is all quite different to here, this specific area we're traversing, but still very nice. Now, Djuma is about 15 kilometers in that direction, like I've said, and the lions are probably about 2 kilometers in that direction, and that's where you're off to. Enjoy.
So, young junior has decided, since no one will let him cuddle them, he's going to cuddle his back leg. So Junior is cuddling his back leg. He's lying a little bit away from the other lions, and I don't think I've ever seen a lion in that particular position. I've seen them in some very strange positions, but never in that exact position. So we had a little bit of movement for a while, but not much. Temperature is dropping quite quickly, so fingers crossed that they are going to get mobile quite shortly. So we've been talking quite a bit about lion hunting and what they eat and stuff like that. So it's been a couple of tough couple of days for the Nkuhumas. Oh. Junior. Oh, there he is. Let go of his back foot now, finally. And in the Greater Kruger National Park, there have been 37 species of prey recorded, from birds to reptiles and even insects. So when a lion is under a lot of stress and pressure to find food, they will find food in remarkable places. I mean, we have seen on the live drives, we have seen the Nkuhuma pride eat a tortoise after a failed lion buffalo hunt. They've been recorded eating termites, porcupines, what other strange things have I seen lions eat? Grasshoppers is another funny one. And also, they are really not at all put off by carrion and absolutely putrid flesh, stuff that's rotten and full of maggots. Oh, there's another one, because they eat the maggots with the rotting meat. So that's another insect. They eat flies. So they are able to subsist off some very strange food sources. And I've just been doing a bit of research in my big book. And there's even a report in the Kruger of lions eating catfish in a drying up pool. Now, I've seen leopard do that, and this is the first time I've ever actually heard or read about lions eating fish. So there is a record, and they would use those front paws that Andrew is now zooming in on, and use those incredibly sharp claws to probably hook those catfish out of a drying puddle of water. But that is very, very interesting. I've even been recorded eating crocodiles. That one I sort of know. I've seen lions have an argument with crocodiles before. Oh, isn't that light beautiful? Look at her eyes. Remember to grab some screenshots, guys, and pop them on Facebook and Twitter, Instagram. Use the hashtag Safari Live. So we've been discussing lion prides and lions in depth, and we have another new viewer, Umang. Welcome, Umang. And Umang would like to know how many prides we have in the reserve and their territories. As we were discussing a bit earlier, the lion, female lion prides territories are not sort of set in stone, and there's this sort of zone that will be utilized by both prides. Umang, in our area, we generally only see two prides regularly, and that is the Nkuhuma pride, who are lying right next to us at the moment, and the Styx breakaway pride, who are currently further to the east of us. But in this northern area of the Sabi Sands, I cannot speak for the whole Sabi Sands, but in this northern area, are the prides that we do see, and I think I've seen three different prides since I've been here. Female prides. Was it four? Three. So we've seen the Styx pride, Nkuhuma pride, and the Tsalala breakaway pride, also known as the Mangen pride. And they, the Mangen pride and Tsalala breakaway, are quite far to the west of us in that area and to the south of us. And they're quite a big pride now, about 14 individuals. And we've got the Nkuhumas, who are 8. And then the Styx breakaways, which are 7, but out of that 7, three are very small cubs, just under 3 months old. So those are our main prides. I would guess in the whole Sabi Sands there's probably 20 to 25 prides that are seen across the whole 60,000 hectares. But in our area we only see generally two prides, with the possibility of the breakaway pride and a very slim possibility of the Talamati pride, which also might move in from the Kruger. But you never know. That's the wonderful thing about the area we operate in. It is a completely massive open system of about 3.5 million hectares. The Greater Kruger National Park, they call it. The Greater Kruger includes the transfrontier parks with Mozambique and Zimbabwe, as well as the private reserves like we are on the edge. So new lions might arrive tomorrow and you will have sometimes no idea where they've come from, and that is one of the exciting things about working in an area like this. But in Nkuhuma pride we probably spend the most time with, and they're sort of our main lion pride. Well, welcome Umang, really great to have you with us, and spread the word about Safari Live and keep sending in some more questions. So as we're saying, we're in a really big, completely open natural system, and generally we like to let nature take its course. So we've got a question from Carla, and she was wondering what would happen if a lion were to contract a disease. Would we intervene? Carla, if it was a disease that is naturally found in lions, we wouldn't. We would let nature take its course. We don't like to interfere. Oh, I've just found, I managed to catch it as he was flying by, hopefully he doesn't fly off, a little click beetle. I'm gonna try a little walk on my fingers. Hopefully he doesn't. He got away. As I caught him, he took off. It was a tiny little click beetle. It's a really fascinating beetle. So they're in the middle of their body. They've got a horn that sort of works like this, and it goes into a junction there. Oh, he's come to Andrew.
Oh, nice catch.
Did I catch him?
I think so.
I did. Okay, don't fly away. Just let everyone... I don't want to hurt him, but unfortunately, that click beetle is not being very... what's the word I'm looking for here? Very, very helpful towards us. But as I was saying, they've got a very interesting adaption. They've got a little horn that's shaped like that, that fits into a hollow in their back. And when you catch them and you hold them, they click. Basically, they send a vibration, like if you clicked your fingers like that, and that vibration is made to give predatory birds or other predatory insects a fright, sort of to jolt, to let go of the beetle, and that's their defense mechanism. Fortunately, I don't have a good insect book here to show you a picture of one, but if you have a look online, I'm sure you can find one. And the biggest one, and probably one of the more impressive ones to have a look at, is called a giant acacia click beetle. And if you want to have a look at what a click beetle looked like, that was a very tiny one, so it would have been quite difficult to see. But have a look online, Google giant acacia click beetle, and you'll get a picture of them. Really, really fascinating insects. And nice to see an insect. We don't see too many insects out during these dry season months, apart from the flies that like to buzz around us and the sweat bees that like to buzz around our eyes. But nice to see an insect, even though it was a very brief visual. And he may hopefully entertained you a little bit while I was grasping at the air, trying to catch it. But here we go. That one wasn't. That was a tiny click beetle. But the best version to have a look at online would be a giant acacia click beetle. That's the amazing thing about the bush. We're sitting here next to some very sleepy lions, and a little click beetle came for a visit. Hello, Ron. Great to have you on the back of the vehicle, Ron. Ron has got a nice question about lion pride feeding habits, basically, and specialization in certain species. And he's noting that he heard of a pride in northern Botswana that specialized in elephants. And you're spot on there, Ron. Quite interesting, I was reading today about lions in the Kruger and their feeding habits and what percentage of it. Strange enough, wildebeest rank quite highly in this area, but the Kruger lions, and especially lions in this area, have been known to specialize in buffalo. And particularly at this time of the year, when those big buffalo herds are forced onto the water points, it makes it a little bit easier for the lions to hunt them. But like all predators, they are opportunists. And they will generally take what's in front of them, but there seem to be a preference for buffalo in this area. But they will eat anything they can get their paws on, literally. As for those elephants in northern Botswana, I've actually been lucky enough to witness two elephant lion hunts, and there was more than one pride that specialized in elephant hunting in Botswana. The most famous of that pride, the most famous pride that got quite a lot of media coverage on their elephant hunts, was the pride around the Savuti Marsh and the Savuti Channel in northern Botswana. I'm just going to try and move around, see if we can change up the angle. We've been sitting here for a while. And while I do that, I will continue to chat about those elephants in Botswana. I'm quite lucky that I spent a lot of time, and actually spent a lot of my teenage years growing up in the bush in northern Botswana. So we're lucky enough to that, but that pride that got a lot of press with the hunting of elephants, I actually have been lucky enough to see quite a few times. And there's a really, really interesting story in that, that those lions lived in an area called the Savuti Marsh. How's that, Andrew? Perfect. And the Savuti Marsh is a sort of very seasonal wetland that gets very wet at times and can be wet for a couple of years, and then it can dry for 20 years. So it dried up in the late 70s and then only started flowing again in the mid 2000s, and it's now apparently started drying again already. So with that there on is that a lot of your species like wildebeest and zebra and that were only there for the summer months because that water dried up, and they would move through to the permanent rivers like the Linyanti and the Kwando. And the lions were left because obviously there are other lions that hold territory on the permanent rivers. So it was one of the, quite a difficult situation for those lions. But a lot of young elephant bulls would stay and feed off those really muddy water holes that survived through the dry season. And due to a lack of other choice of prey, those lions started focusing on elephants sort of between 15 and 20 years old and became quite successful. And also those prides became very big to deal with those very big animals. And as soon as that water came back in the mid-2000s, and those lion prides actually split into smaller groups and focused more on the more traditional zebra, wildebeest, buffalo. So it was very interesting, and I think it happened to be that elephant were the only sort of the most common food source available, so that the pride actually developed and learned how to hunt them. So while we continue with these flat cats, we've got one head up and some yawns going on, so it is looking a little bit better. So we're going to cross to a striped donkey with Scotty, and we'll be back a little later.
Welcome back, and I'm fairly certain the Nkuhuma pride of lion would love to be where we are now, because this would be a very tasty item of prey for them. Thankfully though, for the zebra, they have nothing to fear about, because they are quite some distance from that pride of lion, and therefore they have little threats in this area. A leopard would not be able to take down an adult zebra of this size, would be very unlikely. Although Tingana, the male leopard, who we are hopefully going to bump into sometime this evening, was seen in November with a young zebra foal that he killed. So if there are any foals within this herd, they need to watch out, because the male leopard was heading in this general direction. But I'm not sure, it's very thick here. I'm sure there are members within this dazzle of zebra, but in all likelihood, all of the foals are even quite big now. A lot of them would have been born in October, November, December last year, during the first summer rains, when then there was a lot of green grass to feed on. Now you can see they aren't really spoiled for choice, and all they can really feed on is this dried and yellowing grass. But they should be fine. And this one certainly still looking very healthy, even though it has been quite a dry season in terms of rainfall during the summer months, and therefore in the dry months of the year, the winter months, it does become harder for animals like these to find their food. Well, she turns away from us again. I'm hoping you may be able to see a vertical. No, we've kind of missed it now. You might get a small gap through those bushes, and as she wags her tail, you'll notice a vertical black stripe between her white hindquarters. And this is indicative of a female. The male's rump will touch together and lack that vertical white stripe, which would be perfectly covered by a tree now as it wags its tail. So both the birds and the zebras are not interested in my plans this afternoon, but it goes like that some days. And maybe tomorrow we'll get a little bit more lucky on this vehicle. Very good. Let's continue. We may get a glimpse of a few more around this next corner. And that's looking good. Yeah, this is going to be great, actually. Now, look closely on the road there. Oh, it's just been chased off by the zebra. But it may continue to dust bath. There's a little oxpecker on the road. And I love watching them dust bath. It really is funny to watch. Come on, one more time. Nope. And the zebra have now bombshelled off into some more thick bush, but we may get a few more views as the road continues to meander through this bush. Zebras make a wonderful call. It's my kind of impersonation. And curious one would like to know, when would they let out this call? It's usually in times of excitement. Either when they're being chased by a lion, or when they're fighting amongst themselves, possibly stallions having a fight. But it's often in stages of excitement. The last time I actually heard it was when we came out on a night drive after broadcast, and we were looking for the Nkuhuma pride that obviously startled a herd of zebra that ran off crying out. So this young one we're looking at, I think, is probably the maximum size that a leopard would be able to take. I've never actually seen a leopard with a zebra kill, but I have heard of them killing zebra and even young giraffe. Wouldn't that be incredible to see? Speaking of giraffe kills, one happened just yesterday morning, I believe, just to the west of Arethusa. The Salada Breakaway Pride, a pride of lion we have seen on a handful of occasions. It's a large pride, 13 lion. They managed to catch and kill an adult male giraffe, which is a huge, huge item of prey to take down, and also a very dangerous one. If you were to catch a stray hoof from an animal that size, it could kill you instantaneously or leave you with a fatal injury. good news, everyone. Finally, the lion have started to move, so rush off to them. Enjoy. I wish I was coming with. See you later.
Welcome back, guys. And as the last lioness walks past the setting sun, we're going to have to move. Looks like they've got mobile. I can't see behind me. Can you see, Andrew?
There's two
sub adults, and of course, young Djuma is taking up the rear, and he hasn't even lifted his head yet. Oh, he's lifted his head, but that's about it. There he is, deciding to get up. He's going to walk past the setting sun right in front of us. Isn't that a spectacular shot, guys? Get ready on the screenshots as he gets that amazing late afternoon African light. Oh, no, it's a bit early to get moving, I think, for young Djuma. But we want to keep up with the girls, so in case they start jumping and playing, and as they do quite often when they get moving. I think tonight they're not going to play too much. I think it's going to be quite serious business. The serious business of catching a dinner. And it looks like everyone's waking up a bit slowly. And we've got one of the sub adults just in front of us now. But I can see the adult females disappearing. Unfortunately, I'm in a position where I can't move. I don't want to push the lions unnecessarily. So we have to wait for them to continue on. And that's what we do. We've been sitting and waiting. And as I often say, the most important thing in these really incredible sightings we get from time to time is patience. Being able to spend nearly 3 hours sitting with a lion waiting for it to move can quite often be the difference between catching that incredible moment and not. So the lioness is way up ahead, almost look like they've heard something. I can see their ears are quite cocked, but we're going to move now that our traffic jam has moved along. This is quite a challenging area we're going to follow them through now, but we will do our best to stick with them. This is actually quite typical lion behavior. When they get up to go moving, they'll get up, walk for a little bit, and then lie down again, and then start moving again. We really are amongst the pride now. It looks like they were just waiting for the stragglers to catch up. Oh, using that tree for a nice stretch. So I was talking a little bit about contagious behavior, and there's a perfect example doing almost the exact same thing as the other lioness did, the young sub adult. And quite often with lions, when they do get moving like this, one will urinate or yawn and stretch and start a bit of that social grooming, and it sort of sparks off the rest of them to do the same. I hear oxpeckers. And oxpeckers quite often mean buffalo. So we're on the hunt again with the Nkuhuma pride. This will be our fourth or fifth hunt with these lions in the last few drives. Odds are saying that it's got to be soon that we actually are with them when they actually manage to bring something down. Here comes the lazy cat. Go and onward we go. Heading into an incredibly thick area, we will try to stay with them. Fortunately, I have followed a few animals through here, and I know a little few secret shortcuts. Nkuhuma and Ngala are now up in Mobile in the northeasterly direction, to the south of Mamba Road. Watch out there, honey. Just me, Scotty. So as you can see, sometimes it can be quite challenging following these animals in the bush, especially when they go into areas like this. But so far they've been quite kind in the route they are choosing. And I'm probably going to regret saying that in a few minutes. All right, now. Now I'm awake, little slap to the face. Got into that sort of lion doze mode while we were dozing with lions, but now we're in the hunting mode. That sometimes happens to us out in the bush. That is a big art fog hole that was hidden in the grass. Fortunately, I didn't overcommit, and we'll be able to get out of it. That is a very big one, actually. It's collapsed as well. There you go, that's the big hole we fell into. Now I've got to look out very carefully. So while we follow these lions through this thick bush, we have a really, really big surprise for you. And I wonder who can guess what it is, but we're gonna cross to it right now and we'll be back with the lions a little later.
ignition link. 5, 4, 3, 2.
British, they're coming.
Well, welcome back to an unfamiliar site to those of you who have joined the Wild Earth show in the last couple of weeks. And for those of you who have been watching for a while, you'll know that we introduced bushwalks just a short time ago. A few short weeks for me. It feels like it was just the other day, but I can't believe that it was already and only in April and May that we were trialing this. And I must say, I'm very, very happy to be back, even though with a slightly bigger beard than the last time you saw me. Now, for those of you who have just joined the show, we are doing live bushwalks as an addition to the Wild Earth products. And I'm very excited to tell you that we're standing in the middle of Djuma Private Game Reserve in Sabi San on the Sunset Safari. And we are about to go and have a look at some vultures that I saw in the trees. Behind us. We can't really get a nice shot from where we are, but I'm sure we'll try and update you as we go along. Now, I do, and because we are far away from a lodge and we are far away from vehicles or any type of support, I do have some essential pieces of safety equipment that that you will notice as I'm walking. One is the armband, which I carry currently hidden. This is just to signal to, or any scrutiny that I may get, that I am a registered trails guide for this particular area. And another thing that you'll notice is that I carry a rifle. Now, essentially what the rifle is just a piece of safety equipment similar to a seatbelt or to a car's airbag. One of those pieces of kit that you hope you never need, but you take with and you use religiously in any case, just in case. Now, what I'm going to be doing is heading off through these bushes behind us. It's a monkey thorn thicket, but there are some vultures that I saw on our approach over here. We can't really see them from where we are now, but I'm going to try and get a bit closer and see if we can show it to you. If we do go black screen, this is we have still got some gremlins with the system. If we do go black screen, you're going to be going back to the lions. I hear you've been having a fantastic sighting and the lions are just getting moving. So if you do go black, we will see you soon, or we'll see you soon tomorrow or the next day, and let's see what we can see. Hearing out the bush sounds around you, and so you are able to use hearing to a much bigger effect. And it's one of my primary senses, I must be honest with you. I hear things very often before I see them. And I'm hearing some bushes shaking in front of us over here. I don't quite know what it is. It sounds like it could be some impala or some kudu. It doesn't sound like it's anything too big, but you know, the way elephant tiptoe around this place, I wouldn't be surprised if it's a herd of 20 elephant and I've managed to miss them all. But I can't see anything right now. So we're going to carry on in that direction. There's nothing that's giving me the impression that I need to be overly cautious. It's just, I have heard something, it is in front of us over here, and I'm going to be tuning my senses into the bush in front of us. I must say, what I haven't done, and I feel quite bad about it, is actually introduced who's operating the camera. Jandre is with me on the walk today. and I must say, I really have to say thank you. It's a nice feeling to know that so many of you have welcomed me back to the show. And thank you very, very much. I'm looking forward to uncovering some things for you on trail here over the next coming weeks and months. And really, thank you very much. I appreciate it. So I've come to this particular open patch of ground because I wanted to check this game path over here for any movement of anything. You know, quite often in thick bush like this, animals will be on game paths. But there's nothing on this game path. And I think while we are busy looking for the source of this noise and we approach this tree full of vultures, we're going to be cutting back to the lions. I hear they're on the move. It is dark. I think there's some value for you to go and have a look at there. So we're going to leave you for now. We hope to see you again. Enjoy the lions.
Welcome back, everyone. As you can see, we're still with the Nkuhumas on the move. They're moving past me now. Unfortunately, they are heading generally towards our northern boundary, but I'm hoping they cut, our eastern boundary. I'm hoping they cut further north, maybe towards the Biffles Hook area. Still no sign of Junior way down the road. He's been left behind again. Lazy bones. Looks like they might have heard something or seen something. There's an open area out to the right of us. You can see how close she is to the vehicle, standing by and listening. I always find it how amazing it is watching lions hunt when they take visual cues from each other. So they just look at each other and the one sees what the other's doing and then immediately changes. And you can see this lioness in front of us has just realized that the others look like they might have seen something, and her body language immediately changes. I hope you guys are getting some great screenshots. These are beautiful images of these lions walking straight towards us. So hopefully they have a successful hunt at the sunset safari. Come on, girly, game face on. Two young sub adults and Junior still behind. I can only see the two sub adults. I can't see Junior. I'm gonna just move along with the adults and try to figure out what they might have seen. Unfortunately, they are moving to a slightly open area, so I can actually jump ahead without having an effect and see what they possibly have seen. I thought I saw something right in front of them there for a second. It was just a bush. Something as well. I'm just gonna bypass this lead female. Just have a quick look up ahead to see what it might be that they're possibly smelled or heard or seen. So I'm gonna go out into this open patch in front of us. I'm just gonna stop there and wait. This is an area where those buffalo bulls do like to come rest. And rest during the evenings up on these crests away from the cold of the drainage lines. I'm just going to keep quiet for a minute or so to see if maybe they've heard something. Ah, they've been spotted. You just heard that. And there's a herd of waterbuck I just saw disappearing to the left. We can't see them now, but they were just in there. It looks like they might have Hi Henry, welcome to this lion hunt. Henry would like to know how far away Steph is from me. Henry, I have absolutely no idea. I presume he's somewhere in the southern part of the reserve. I'm way out in the east and near the northeastern corner, but at the moment I actually don't have a clue where Steph is. Look how exquisite that is, guys. You can see those muscles all stretching. And it's quite nice to actually sit a little bit away from the lions. We're often quite close to them, especially when they're sleeping. And to have a look at them with this vista behind them is quite incredible. They seem to be still looking in this general area where the waterbuck were. I think the waterbuck have made good their escape. It's going to be very interesting to see what they do from here. They can obviously still hear or smell something directly behind us that I can't see. I'm still hoping they continue sort of north along the road rather than east towards the boundary. Although, I'm guessing just looking at the body language and where they're looking, that they are going to go east. And it's not very far to the boundary from here. You can see behind them a vast expanse of African bushveld. That is the northern Sabi sands. Definitely still interested in something. It could still be those waterbuck. Or it could be something else. Well, look at that. And spotting, they are already flanking out. So you can see they're definitely showing interest in something. I'm not sure what it is. It is something behind us. And we can see very intent. And this lioness off to the right has dropped her shoulders and gone into that classic lion, sort of stalking, keeping her head low. She's disappeared into some low bush there. And be interesting to see how the other lionesses take those visual cues from her. She's going even further north, so heading even further out. And there, watching, flanking on the southeastern side is another lioness. And then we've got the three, and we've got two adults and one sub-adult in front of us, and then the second, or the last adult female a little bit further down the road. I can just get a few visuals of the lioness far off to the right now, appearing out of those thickets. And you can see by the way she's moving much, much slower than the others when they were moving down the road. Here we go, where are you going, Andrew? To the right. In there.
Well, I can't even see.
Slow to the left. There you go. There she is.
Ah, there we go.
And you can see she's taking very careful and considered steps. And we can hear the Shelley's Franklin in the background. Look, yeah, 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 yeah. Come, quick. Just she's throwing that really nice, close, classical line as she moves. You'll see how she, that lion stalk, that, there we go, intent in the eyes. Something is behind us, and I don't know what it is. But the lions are obviously really onto this now. The other lionesses have all changed their, zebra. I can see them now finally. There's a herd of zebra. The one lioness is probably 25, 30 meters from the herd of zebra. I'm not going to move while I've got lions near me because it might, because the zebra is looking in our general direction at the moment. So I don't want to be the one to give it away. But once these lions go down, I'll move slightly so we can see where the zebra are. Andrew's trying his best to swing around now. We are in a difficult position. You got it there, Andrew? In the gap, next to the big marula.
The camera just can't get there.
Oh, unfortunately, it's just beyond what the camera can, get. The zebra is actually moving towards the lions now, and they've stopped looking near us. Unfortunately, I can see lionesses, and everything's going, they're all on the move. The two lionesses closest. The zebra are sprinting through the bush. I'm not sure what's going on there. They're not sprinting yet. They're actually running towards where the other lionesses went. So we're just going to stand back here. I've just seen a lion go now. We're just going to keep quiet. We can't move now. And there's buffalo as well. Everything's going on. The lions are chasing the buffalo. I can actually see her still chasing buffalo there. Coming right towards us now. Lions with the buffalo right hot on its tail. And they're chasing it towards where the other lions are coming. Junior's actually coming in from right. She's jumped on the buffalo. She's right on its back. She slowed it down. And Junior's there, right in front of them there. Hold on, guys. We're going to get in there now. Junior's got involved in the fight. And all of the lions on top of the buffalo now. Just got to get ourselves in a safe position. There we go. You can see how the one lioness has got her under the throat. The others will try to tire it out now.
So guys, I know this is really difficult for some of you to watch. So please, if you are sensitive viewers, maybe just take a little break. But this is nature at its best.
Stations in Nkuhuma prior to Bambada and Nyari on the junction of Drakensberg and Mamba Road. The Nyari is still standing, but all the Ngala on top of it.
You can hear the buffalo starting to struggle with breathing, and this is by no means over. The other buffalo might come back. I can actually see the one coming back, but we're going to stay on the lines for now, and I'll keep Andrew updated on the movement of the other buffalo. So what they really need to do now is get this buffalo off its feet. So as I said, the fight's by no means over. And you can see quite often lions will also try grip it by the nose. And what that does, and even though it is a very dangerous maneuver, it helps sort of drown the buffalo because it starts breathing in its own blood. And you can see how strong Junior is there when he pulls that back leg. He's trying to get that buffalo on the ground. There's another old buffalo bull, just a little bit wide. He's coming to the left there. You can see him right there. I'm not sure whether he'll come to the aid of this buffalo yet, but it is possible. This fight is by no means over yet. Nope, the buffalo bull is deciding to leave this be. I'm just going to move the vehicle again quickly. So of course we can't get too close in there because you never know what happens, and we've got to be a safe distance away because that buffalo might get loose and run straight towards us. And you'll actually see a view of the other buffalo bull trotting around in the background there. Hasn't quite made up its mind whether it's going to come to the aid of this one, but I think if it is the case, it will have to be quite soon. But you can see there's still a lot of fight in this old boy.
Scott, just keep coming down Drakensberg to the north from Mamba Junction. And there's that open cruiser spot that's been mowed, and you'll get our visual there. We're just to the east of the road. Ahead, yours. The Nkuhumas have just bumped a Nyari. It's still alive, though. It's still standing, all the lines on top. You can see now, as soon as they get it down to the ground, is what they keep trying to do at the moment. But as I said, the fight is not over, and these buffalo bulls are incredibly resilient. As you can see, the buffalo's managed to free the lioness off the neck, and she's had to change for that nose hold I was talking about. It is a really dangerous position for that lioness now. She could be flung very, very easily.
There we go, they've got it down. That's sort of the battle, most of the battle won now.
Well, this is very, very interesting stuff to see, and we have been waiting a very, very long time to share this with you. It is harsh, but it is nature taking its course. We actually heard the buffalo bellowing from Twin Dams where we were parked, listening for any noises. But we're going to send you back to Brent, he's got a much better angle.
Welcome back, everyone. Isn't this amazing? I told you, patience is the most important weapon in your arsenal. And it's taken us about 7 drives with the Nkuhuma Pride. And I said the law of averages has to work out into our favor eventually. And now, with patience, we thought they were after zebra, but there were also buffalo we couldn't see there.
Craig, there are 3 stations here. Or 2 stations here, yours making as well. Sorry, go again. That's affirmative.
So guys, isn't this absolutely incredible? As you can see, it is a really harsh reality here. The buffalo is not even dead yet, and the animals are starting to feed on it. The lioness at the front is still on the nose, and she might have changed her grip. I can't see from where I am at the moment. But we're gonna change to Scotty, who might have an angle of that around the throat. So we're gonna cross across to Scotty quickly.
Now you can see 2 lioness busy trying to suffocate this buffalo. One is gripping down onto the track here, onto the windpipe, and the other one on top is attempting to try and block the nostrils. They need to block both tracts to try and suffocate this buffalo more effectively, but it can take time. It's not going to happen quickly necessarily, but despite that, some lion have started to feed. So some lion are feeding on the rear of this buffalo, and it is brutal, but it will be in shock. I'm guessing it's possibly the 2 older lioness that are possibly doing the coup de grace, making sure that it's dead while the youngsters feed, but that will change once it is dead, and they'll probably do their best to chase the younger lioness away. As you can see, it's not easy for them to break through the hide of this buffalo. You may have just noticed some aggression there, and we've spoken about this before. Around the dinner table, there will be a lot of aggression. For now, it's okay because they all know there's a lot of food, but once they do break open the carcass, they will start competing with one another to try and get as much food as they each can. Now, I know it's harsh, and I know a lot of you would wish this could happen faster, but it is a very, very difficult animal to kill, and also a very dangerous one. And we've watched these same lion
on many, many occasions try their best to bring down buffalo, but they've actually been made to look silly. Eventually now they have got lucky. But it's not over yet. That was actually audio of lions still fighting with one another. It wasn't the buffalo that you could hear, but it is still alive. You can still see those two lioness trying their best to slow the oxygen intake of this buffalo. But it's a massive animal and even they are battling. These may be the final bellows from the buffalo. They will often let out one final groan. You may have heard Brent repositioning, and he's got a great different angle, so over to him and we'll see you a bit later.
Welcome back with us, guys. You can see we've measured around, you can see that lioness is still firmly attached to the nose. If we go in a little bit closer there, please, Andrew. Oh, you can see a bit of that aggression in the background. I actually think, if we look very carefully, when we moved here, initially the buffalo was still alive, but I think it is now moved on to the next plane. That lioness will stay attached. There we go, she's loosening her grip a little bit. I think she could have felt that. There we go, that buffalo has just died. When we first moved here, I could still see some movement in the eye. And here, some breathing, but she has managed to suffocate that from that really, really difficult hold around the buffalo's nostril. So, and a very dangerous position. We saw that incredible. While she was thrown up in the air, she hung on for dear life there. So she was able to suffocate that buffalo while the rest of the pride. And you can see now where Junior, who's a young male, becomes a really vital part. His extra weight and strength was able to topple that buffalo down. We might see some of that famed lion unfriendly feeding now. What an absolutely incredible, incredible afternoon. What a sunset safari. I'm just taking a moment to sort of calm down after that amazing excitement we had there. And it is sad, and I know a lot of people have found it quite difficult to watch the lions bring down this buffalo bull. But they are have been really hungry, so now this will sustain the pride, and they're going to be on this kill for a few days. Guys, we're gonna cross back to Scotty from a different angle. You might be able to see a bit more of the feeding dynamics that are going on than we can from this angle. But what an amazing, amazing sunset safari. And over to Scotty.
Now, it appears that they've all kind of got their place around the dinner table, but that will change, and we can expect to see some growling. Junior earlier swatted one of the youngest lions, the sub-adults, as it tried to squeeze in next to him. And this is going to go a long way for these lion. It is a very difficult thing to watch, but it is nature, and there's no other way for these animals to survive. And you may have heard a few growls. Understandably, there are a few vehicles trying to rush here to get involved in this action, and Brent has very kindly offered to make space, so it'll just be us here, but he's going to stay as long as he can before the other vehicles arrive, and that way we'll be able to cover this action from as many angles as possible. I think if we stay on this wide shot, it'll be our best bet, because if any one of them does lash out at another, and we'll be able to see it, and it all happens so quickly. Watch here, watch here. There's been a bit of a shift. Let's watch what happens. Whenever you see some repositioning, you know that there could be some action, as they may try and vie for another spot where it's easier to obtain more meat more efficiently and more quickly. And they will be in a rush. They don't know what other lion are in the area. They have been chased off kills recently by one single lion from apparently the Styx pride, so that will be in the back of their mind. While Brent is here, we are going to make the most of it and keep chopping and changing between the two different angles. So jump across onto Brent's vehicle and we'll see you shortly.
Welcome back, everyone. Hasn't this been absolutely amazing? How are yours?
Thanks for letting me in here.
No problem. So yours has just come to join us, but hasn't this been an absolutely spectacular sunset safari? As I often say, the most important weapon in your arsenal to seeing these amazing sightings is patience. And we spent nearly 2.5 hours with flat, absolutely flat lions. So they... So while these lions tuck in to their dinner, we have literally spent, I think, 7 drives with Nkuhuma prides now. This is the fifth attempt at buffalo that we've seen, and finally success. And I kept saying, guys, we've got to stay with them even when they're sleeping. You never know what's going to happen. And this is just what's happened. So after all these failed attempts of hunts and many hours with quite often very flat cats, our patience has finally paid off. And what we have here is a very happy Nkuhuma pride who were looking quite hungry today. So we found them this morning in that really big block of bush between Leadwood Road and Mumba Road. And they'd already stopped moving for the day and they'd gone flat. And we came back this afternoon and they just showed signs of getting moving a little bit earlier than before. So we just waited it out. And they got up, they lay down, they got up, they lay down. I just had that sort of sneaky suspicion that tonight was the night, so to speak. And then they started moving. And then as they got out onto the road and up onto the crest, they had a view. They started looking off to the northeast, and weren't sure what they were. We saw some waterbuck run away from them. Then we saw some zebra running towards them. And then I just suddenly saw lions running off into the bush. And then all of a sudden the zebra went that way, and back towards us came running about three or four buffalo bulls with these two lionesses chasing them. She jumped right onto its back right next to us. And then the other lionesses and Junior came storming out. He was miles behind them and managed to add his weight to that. And very fortunately for this buffalo, they managed to kill it quite quickly. I think it probably took only 15 minutes or so to die. I have seen them last for over an hour. So quite a merciful kill. But also I think in these circumstances, there's so much adrenaline and shock going through that animal's body that they're probably not feeling too much. And I know for some of you, this is an incredibly difficult thing to watch. But it is nature at its finest, and it's the circle of life continuing. And those Nkuhumas, if they don't get to eat a buffalo every now and then, they'll disappear. So what an amazing, amazing couple of days. And it's been unbelievable to stay with the lions as long as we have, and build and stay with them as they've got more hungry and more hungry. And to finally see them with a really good meal is a really great reward for the time we've spent with them over the last three or four days. See the lioness who did most of the killing? Is only started feeding now. She would have been really, really tired after hanging onto that buffalo's nose for so long. So she's only started feeding now. And at the moment, while there's still quite a lot of meat around, there's not going to be too many fights. But I think as the meat gets less, there could be a few more arguments to come. And just a big thank you from myself to everyone out there who's saying what a great job we did. And as I said, finding animals is definitely a team game, and I could definitely not have done it without Scotty's help from this morning. And he definitely had the most to do with us being able to find them in that track. We were just fortunate that our spring stayed intact and we were able to continue on into that block. But it has been an incredible week staying with these animals. Going to cross across to Scotty, who's just on the other side of a buffalo, and we'll be back a little later.
Well, I'm sitting here in awe, and finally we've got in the action, and isn't it awesome that you are all there to see it? We got you in the final moments when the buffalo was still standing, so I still saw some of it, but really happy that all of you got to see the whole hunt. So many of you have watched a lot of hunts but have yet to actually see a takedown. It's not something that happens very often, and as brutal as it is, it's an important thing in nature and important to understand
how effective these animals are at doing their business. It's a hugely difficult member of prey for them to take down. Anyway, exciting stuff for the Nkuhuma Pride and for Safari Live. I hope you all enjoyed it, and we're going to send you back to Brent. Thanks to VM, and thanks to Tara and Nikki and Final Control. We'll see you all tomorrow, probably here. Cheers.
Any of them here, Brent?
All of them.
Eight or nine?
Eight.
Eight.
Welcome back, everyone. We're back with the Nkuhumas. You can see closest to us is, there we go, one of the sub-adults. And she's trying to get a good spot to feed, but because she's smaller than the others, she isn't really succeeding, and that's why we saw her trying to chew on the buffalo's nose a bit there. So at the moment, we can't really, there we go, there's going to be a bit of aggression, a bit of fighting. And that's why I say, when you see a lot of those scars on the lions, it's from them fighting over their dinner. So we saw this, the lioness actively suffocating this buffalo. William would like to know, is it possible that the buffalo might bleed out before the suffocation process is complete? It's very unlikely, William, unless another lion happens to open up an artery in the groin or whatnot. Normally suffocation is the way that most of these bigger prey species will go, whether it be from inhaling their own blood and drowning, or from that grip around the throat, around the lungs, or from that nasal grip we've just seen. I'm just going to try and move us around to the other side a little bit to see if I think we're good here. I think there's going to be a little battle there between that sub-adult and the others. She's just trying to worm her way into a gap there. Oh, looks like she's managed to succeed a little bit. And when the carcass becomes a bit more open, it'll probably be easier. What we can't see now is Junior, and he's probably managed to get into the stomach, and he would have gone for the heart and the liver and the lungs first. There is a lot of nutrients and a lot of minerals. So, fortunately, the whole Nkuhuma Pride is here, all eight individuals. And so, Kathleen, there are eight lions there. The whole Nkuhuma Pride is in for a decent meal after a very hungry four or five nights. Guys, what an incredible sunset safari. Finally now, I think my excitement has calmed down a little bit. I'm going to say a very quick goodbye and thanks very much for joining us. And don't forget to join us on the Sunrise Safari. We'll definitely be coming back here. Thank you for all your questions. But we're just going to stick on the lines for the last few minutes to see what they're up to. I will still keep chatting if I see anything to chat about. But there is going to be a bit more aggression than that. Unfortunately, there are other game drives, and we have spent nearly a full 3 hours with these lions. We actually will have spent a full 3 hours with these lions by the time of closing. And I'm going to let the other guys get a chance to come in and view this as well. And we were there for the really exciting stuff. So it's only fair that we give everyone a chance and they do the same for us as well. So we'll just watch them for the last while. Hopefully there'll be some snarling and growling. Other than that, we will definitely come check on this carcass first thing tomorrow morning. I think we're about to get some of that snarling quite shortly. You can actually hear them cutting through the flesh there, and it'll take a while for them to use those sort of premolars to cut through the flesh to actually get to a lot of the meat. A buffalo hide is very tough. There's some of that incredible aggression. I'm just going to keep quiet for the last few seconds and drive and just let you guys enjoy this incredibly powerful sound.